Comparing People. He's a professor of sociology at Simon Fraser University. Professor Tipo has many publications, including Relations of Global Power, Neoliberal Order and Disorder, and The Riddle of Human Rights. The title of his talk today is The Neglected Chapters on Wages in Capital.
Thanks very much for the introduction, and it's a great pleasure to be here. Before I begin, I wanted to thank the organizers of the conference. This has obviously been a very timely conference, and given the attendance, it's obviously of great interest to a very large number of people. So I think in particular, Marcello Musto should be singled out, and the person that I wanted to say thanks to was also Lynn Denham, who was the first person to approach me about participating. So many thanks to the organizers, all of them. There are many. Organizing a conference is a thankless task, but maybe by the end of today, they'll have received enough thanks to make it not seem so thankless. The title of the talk was The Neglected Chapters on Wages, and I hope that by the time I'm finished talking about it, you'll agree that they have been neglected, and that they actually are a singularly important set of chapters to look at, not so much in so far as what they say, but in the sense that they reflect on the whole of the volume one and the volume and the other two volumes of Capital. Buried close to the center of Capital, roughly 1,000 pages, are these chapters on wages. There are four of them, chapters 19, 20, 21, 22. They're actually quite short in total. They make up less than, well, probably no more than 40 pages, given the size of some of his other chapters, which amount to dozens and dozens of pages. These are very short. But in fact, despite the shortness, Marx says something quite extraordinary about them. He says, I'm going to quote, I won't read very much of this paper, I'll just speak to the argument. The paper is rather too long and the time we have is too short. So but let me read this quotation. He says, towards the end of chapter 19, he says, we may understand the decisive importance of the transformation of the value and price of labor power into the form of wages, or into the value and price of labor itself. All the notions of justice held by both the worker and the capitalist, all the mystifications of the capitalist mode of production, all capitalism's illusions about freedom, all the apologetic tricks of vulgar economics have as their basis the form of appearance discussed above, wages, which make the actual relations invisible and indeed presents to the eye the precise opposite of that relation. All right, so those are rather impressive claims that he's making for the wage form, and I'll go back over each one of those in a few minutes. But let's turn now to ask, well, what actually is Marx trying to do in these four chapters? Well, really the first three chapters, and I'll come to the fourth chapter in a few minutes. But so that's the question. I was in the original paper, I was going to leave you hanging on that question. What is he actually trying to do? And then over the course of the paper establish it. But since we don't have time, I'm going to actually answer the question for you. So no exam today. So he's trying to do two things, and you can reduce those chapters to these two items. He is actually drawing out the ideological nature of the wage form. And secondly, he's showing us how the wage form itself is used to defraud workers. So those two things basically sum up the entire impact or the entire arguments of those chapters, minus chapter 22. Well, the ideological aspect is something that I think is should be of great interest to us, because I have heard the word ideology used in this conference several times already, and it is not the way Marx uses it. Marx uses ideology on several occasions in Capital, and this is the one occasion where he actually spends a little bit of time defining it very clearly, although there are other occasions or in Capital where he does define it, although it's very, very brief. But what he says, and he actually begins chapter 19 by saying, on the surface of bourgeois society, wages appear as the price of labor. All right? So The interesting thing about that that sentence is that this chapter and chapter 20 and 22, 21 are actually a move away from the more strictly value-based analysis that you find in the previous 18 chapters and in the subsequent chapters, minus some of the more historical, the shorter, more historical chapters in 26, 27, 28, around that, in that area. So in effect, Marx has been tracing the journey taken by value from chapter 1 right through to chapter 18. And then in chapter 19, he says, on the surface of bourgeois society, wages appear as the price of labor. So he's moving away from a value analysis into the level of appearance. The world of appearance is not the world that he has been working at, is not the level which he's been working at up until this point. Chapter 18, the one that precedes the part 5 on wages, here Marx takes up the issue of the difference between labor and labor power that he says political economy, mainstream political economy, confuses. Now he's also looked at that question of labor and labor power in chapter 6, the sale and purchase of labor power, and in chapter 7 on the labor process. So this question of the difference between labor and labor power has been established long in chapters long before chapter 19, but here he's reiterating it. It almost looks as if it's a repetition, but he's stressing the point that labor is in fact, labor is in fact the expenditure of energy. And labor, he says, has no value in itself. It's simply time spent expending energy. What the worker is paid for, he says, is labor power. In other words, it's the skills, it's the experience, it's the knowledge that a worker brings to the contract with the employer. That's what a worker is paid for. And the value of labor power is established by the socially necessary labor time required to produce the means of subsistence for that worker. The worker is not paid for labor. Labor is the time that you are employed for. 1 hour, 2 hours a week, 10 days, a month, a year. Right? You are not paid for that. You're paid for your labor power. So Marx is saying, wages are presented as the price of labor, whereas what wages really are, or in essence, we'll use that word a little more now, in essence, wages are the price or the exchange value of labor power. That's the value analysis. Wages are at a different level. It's the level of appearance. In other words, that wages are the ideological expression of the exchange value of labor power, right? Or the price of labor power. It's ideological because, and this is Marx's definition, I'm not imposing this on Marx, it's very clear in this chapter. It's ideological because it takes appearance as if it were the essence. In other words, wages appear to be something that they are not. It appears to be remuneration for time spent, for energy expended, but that is not what wages are. Wages are the socially necessary labor, the value of that socially necessary labor to reproduce the skills, and the knowledge, the life of the worker. Now, so here is what Marx says in that very chapter, just to emphasize the point. He says, it is not labor which directly confronts the possessor of money, the employer, on the commodity market, but rather the worker. What the worker is selling is his labor power, and as soon as his labor actually begins, it is already ceased to belong to him. It can therefore no longer be sold by him. Labor is the substance, the imminent measure of value, but has no value in itself. Right? It's very important to realize that, because that's the heart of the ideological nature of wages. All right. So the issue is that we think we're being paid for the time that we work, and the But the ideological initiatives will really not be paid for. We're being paid for part of the time that we're working. And with peace wages is slightly different, but we'll come to that in a few minutes. So we're paid only for part of the time. The time that we're working, whether it's 10 minutes or an hour or a day or a week or a month or a year, we are always working part of that time to replace the value of our wages, of our labor power, the V plus S, which is Marx's symbols for variable capital and surplus segment. But in every moment that you're working, every hour you're working, or a week or a month or a year, you are working to produce two parts to the value, to the total product. One part is the value of your wages, salaries. The other part is surplus. So no matter you're working for 1 second, you wouldn't be creating very much value, but whether it's 10 minutes, an hour, a day, you are working always to produce value that's broken into two parts, the value of your wages, and the surplus. When wages are called the price of labor, that division between the value of your own remuneration and the surplus is disguised, it's camouflaged, it's hidden. You cannot see it. This is where Marx introduces, and he's done this on a couple of occasions already, where he introduces the examples of the corvée in serfdom and slavery, where he points out that the corvée, you know when you're working for yourself, and you know when you're working for the manor lord. In slavery, it always appears to the slave that one's labor time is always, the entire labor time is unpaid. But the point he makes is, for a slave, part of the time a slave works is to remunerate or to create the living requirements of the slave, and the rest is surplus. But for the worker, under the capitalism of production, the worker cannot see that division and thinks that, workers think that the whole time they're working, they are being paid for that. This is encapsulated in the phrase, a fair day's work for a fair day's pay. Pure ideology. Right? And that phrase has been part and parcel of the labor movement for decades, and still is. But it's pure ideology, right, in Marxism. You're not being paid for the time that you're working. You're being paid for a portion of that time, and the rest of the time you're producing surplus. All right, so that's the nature of the ideology. It disguises the appearance. You're being paid, you're told you're being paid for an hour, a week, a day. You're being told that's the time you're working, and you're being paid for it. You're fully remunerated for the time spent. But in doing that and accepting that as the nature of your wage, you're also disguising for yourself the time that you've been producing surplus for the employer. All right, so let's go back to the phrase, the paragraph that I read at the outset, where Marx says, we may understand the decisive importance of the transformation of the value and price of labor into the form of wages, or the value and price of labor itself. And here's where he says, all the notions of justice held by both the worker and the capitalist. So everybody's befuddled by the wage form. Nobody escapes this ideology. We can come back and talk about the university as an institution that is ideological and see how many of us escape the idea that we're really living in, well, I won't go down that road too far. So all the notions of justice, well, this we assume can refer to the implication that wages are seen to represent equal value for equal value. Fair day's work for a fair day's pay. Whereas, in fact, the value of variable capital and wages in exchange for producing the value of V plus S, the value of your wages and the surplus. You think you're getting full value for the time spent, you're actually only getting part of it. But you're confounded by the fact that the appearance belies the essence. So this is the mystification, all the mystifications of the capitalist mode of production. So here we think, well, it's probably referring to the obscuring the source of surplus value, allowing profit to be seen as maybe an addition at the point of sale, which is the way most economists treat profit. It's something tacked on rather than something that's built into the production process itself. Then he says, the illusions about freedom, and this probably points to the idea that the contract is between equals. Well, it can't be between equals because they're two equals with no advantage to either side, but in fact, one side has to work. One side has no choice in this contract, while the other side can choose who gets to work. So it's obviously not an equal contract. But not only that, the contract is necessary to both sides. One side is not a matter of choice, it has to go to work, and the other actually can needs it also to work in order to produce the surplus. So the illusions of freedom that are involved in a contract between two equal parties, free in free will, in joining together, is, of course, using the analysis of wages, then nonsense. As far as the apologetic tricks of political economists, well, here is again where profit appears to arise in the circulation process and not in the production process, obscuring the nature of exploitation of workers. All right, so, and on and on. All right, so you get the drift. Marx, for Marx, wages disguise the necessary and surplus labor type, the time for producing variable capital and surplus. All right, so that's the ideological import, but I wanted to read, just to finish that question of ideology, I wanted to read one more passage from this section where Marx actually maps out what he means by ideology. And I recommend this to you so that the use of the word ideology, if you want to use it in concert with the way Marx means it, you can find this here. So here's what Marx says in page 682 of the usual edition of Capital. He says, "What is true of all forms of appearance and their hidden background meaning essence is also true of the form of appearance of value and price of labor, or wages, value and price of labor." Always remember, labor then is expenditure of energy, and it has no value, but the wage form makes it appear as if it has value. So he says, as contrasted with the essential relation manifested in it, namely the value and price of labor power, the forms of appearance are reproduced directly and spontaneously as the current and usual modes of thought. Wages, equal value, you know, fair days work, fair days pay, it seems reasonable. The essential relation must first be discovered by science. This classical political economy stumbles approximately into the true state of affairs, but actually, I won't go on there. All right, so you get the drift. That's Marx's notion of ideology. It's confusing appearance for essence. And the whole of the analysis of Capital is really at the level of essence or a value analysis that is hard to do. So I'll go over some of that because I think I have a bit more time. So when Marx now turns in chapter 21 to examine time wages, effectively he begins that chapter by saying, well, wages take many different forms. So then it becomes a question of all the different forms, time, peace, maybe commission, maybe tips, maybe the Christmas turkey, maybe special holidays for people who win a contest at work. All kinds of forms of wages are there, and they disguise the actual relation underlies it. So when he says he's going to look at two of the forms, time wages and peace wages, which are the two more common forms. Two most common forms for you and I, probably. Although, as I said, many of us, if you've especially worked in a restaurant, then you will be getting wages in other forms. You can take a variety of forms. So with time wages, effectively said there, and makes the point much of which I've made already, that it appears as if you're getting paid for all the time that you are at work, whereas in fact, you're only being paid for part of that time, and the rest is production of surplus. The rest of that chapter of 21 on time wages, he spends doing the second thing I said was the main two things about these chapters on wages, and that is he shows how wages can be used to defraud workers of the value of their labor power. So when you are firmly convinced that you're getting paid for the full time that you're at work, there are a whole variety of ways in which that can be manipulated to extract more circles out of you than you would if your wage actually was strictly for the value of your labor power as opposed to also producing surplus. So I won't go through all those ways and means of defrauding the worker. Many of you will actually know and have experienced that kind of fraud. It takes place daily, all the time, across the board. All right, so that's what he does in time wages, very revealing. Then when we come to chapter 21, of peace wages, it's the same problem here, and that is that when you're paid by the piece, that is to say you produce or whatever, a widget, or you produce, or you may be paid for a certain amount of time, let's say sessionals in a university are often paid according to a particular period of time that they are working. That might well be argued as a form of piece wage. You get a lump sum for a certain amount of time, which is not so much time as a kind of a piece. But nevertheless, let's think in terms of widgets. When you produce a widget and you're getting a certain amount of remuneration per widget. All right, so it appears that you're being paid for all the labor that you put into the production of that widget. But what in fact he says in this chapter is that the value of that widget contains the same division between the value of your labor power and surplus. So every widget that you produce, even though you think you're being paid the full value for the labor in that widget, in fact you're not. There is a division. So there again, there's an ideological element of peace wages, which makes it appear that you're getting full value for your labor, whereas in fact, it's not the case. And then he goes on for the rest of that chapter to show the degrees and the ways in which workers can be defrauded with peace wages. And in fact, peace wages have many, many more opportunities for defrauding the worker than time wages, and it's a really widely used. Given the amount of time I have, what I'm going to just simply say, well, if we take the argument that I've made so far, and if you then go back and read from chapter 1 on, you actually read it with quite different eyes, because you will begin to see that from chapter 1 on, I've only briefly said what I in the paper map art in much more detail, is that chapter 1 is the derivation of the question of value. So all human products have use value and value, but value only appears when two products are exchanged, and then they appear as the exchange value, right? But all human products have value. In other words, socially necessary labor time. All human societies allow only so much time to produce the use values necessary. All right, well, I take that back. I didn't include academia, but socially necessary labor time is, generally speaking, always a requirement of any social formation. All right, so then he develops the question of value, and then the rest of capital is the journey that value takes in its development. So part one is the journey that value takes from being from an isolated and accidental form to the form of money, right? And in money, value takes an independent form, a form of its own. So value now has got its own form. It's no longer embodied in various commodities, but it's now has its own form. And money is not a passive thing. Remember the wonderful passages that Marx quotes from Shakespeare regarding the power of money. It's a social power, and when accumulated, it can do things. It has a capacity. And from then, he goes on to talk about capital. So if you remember, when you move into the circuit for capital, so instead of the circuit for exchange, which is CMC, where M is money and simply facilitates the exchange, and the value on all sides of that is the same. The value for the original C is X, for money it's X, and for the final C it's X. So there's no augmentation of value. With capital, of course, the circuit changes. M, C, M, and the prime. In other words, you're augmenting value. So the rest of capital then is how value is augmented. And here we're talking about the production of new value, which is V plus S. So all new value created by labor is the value of labor power and a surplus. So the rest of capital is about the division of V and S. All right? That's the rest of capital. So every chapter that you read, it'll take on a new light because it's always about that division and the contest between labor and capital over the share of the total social product. That's capital. When you come to the end of capital, the quizzical chapter 33, which people have trouble understanding on the theory of colonization, Marx puts it there because there, Marx says, here mainstream political economy finally discovers the fact that surplus value or capital on its own can't do anything without labor. Right? And that's discovered in the colonies. Canada is a good example. All right, so the final point. Chapter 22 is on the national division, a national difference in wages. And here Marx makes the point that if you're going to determine the difference in national wages, then you have to take into account the length of the working day, the level of productivity, the intensity of labor, history, customs, and so on, all of which remain somewhat valid today. Although I would argue that the national differences in wages are rapidly disappearing. So that what Marx said in chapter 22 is really not all that applicable anymore. There is a distinct sort of verifiable leveling of wages across the world. And I'll quickly end here by pointing out there are probably four reasons why this leveling is, three reasons why this leveling is taking place. I have evidence to show this leveling, which I don't have time to do. First of all, there's a two-tiered labor market, which wasn't in Marx's day. So the two-tiered labor market suggests there's a global labor market, which is accessible only by the corporate sector. It's not accessible by trade unions or the working classes. The working classes have another layer of labor markets. And here is that they're restricted to the national or local or regional labor markets. They're legislated, they're defined by these labor markets. They have no way of getting into the realms in which the corporate sector can dwell. All right, we don't have time to develop that idea. The growth of the Industrial Reserve Army was in, if you read chapter 25, Marx pays an enormous, or attributes enormously to this Industrial Reserve Army as having an impact on wages. And if you look today at the growth of the global Industrial Reserve Army, you have to be impressed or depressed by the enormous size of it that's growing in terms of the informal economy, in terms of growing numbers of unemployed and underemployed, in terms of the vast uncounted populations of the slums around the world, prison labor, and on and on. So you begin to realize that the Industrial Reserve Army that has this huge impact on leveling wages is alive and well and growing rapidly. The third point I want to make is the robotization, I'm coming to an end now, the robotization of production, or the computerization, automation of production and distribution around the world. So here again, this is, I would have liked to develop this at some length, but I'll curb my comments and point out that with a world now that we live in with global production chains or value chains, it's impossible to look upon really virtually anything you can imagine that isn't sourced or developed or processed in a whole variety of countries. And this has a distinct leveling effect on wages, simply because virtually everything we consume is a product of a global economy. We're not talking international, we're talking a global economy. Right? The big difference. One last point. In the Grundrisse, like shift from capital now to Grundrisse, Marx makes a point, and you're probably, many of you familiar, and maybe all of you familiar with the very well-known passages on machinery. And here Marx makes some remarkable and interesting claims that have more or less come to be realized. Here Marx talks about machines and the, well, he's talking about the organic composition of capital. The fact that capital constantly increases the side of constant capital and in the organic composition, the side of labor constantly declines. And so when the Grand Briefly talks about machines making machines, actually there's a passage that says machines making machines. But he couldn't have known today that we have machines that make machines that make machines and on and on. So we're living in a world now in which the possibility of machines making virtually everything is actually, we can actually talk about it. It's there. All right? So what does that mean? When machines make machines, it means that less and less value is created, because the only thing that creates value is labor. So the more machines make things, the less value there are in those things. And Marx draws the conclusion. He says it's quite conceivable, given the logic of his argument, to imagine a world of products with no value. No value. Only use values. Right? Because there's no longer any labor in it. And if there's no labor, then there's no wages, there's no profits, there's no capitalism of production. And this is where he reintroduces the notion of the forces and relations of production. So here's where he says, the forces of production have led us to a point where we can produce everything for everyone in the form of use values, no value. And he says, but this continues to be produced in a world, relations structure, a world of private property, where there's an obligation to realize these use values in terms of buying and selling. And he says, at this moment, the system, and I think the translation of the German, although I'm sure about it might not be correct, but this is where he says, this is the moment that the system blows up. Thanks very much.